Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel. Let's get on to PIB dated 3rd, 4th and 5th of January 2020. The first press release was with regard to this thing wherein Prime Minister of India paid tribute to Savitri Bhai Phule on her Jayanti. So information about Savitri Bhai Phule becomes important for our prelims as well as for our mains exam. So let's begin. So Savitri Bhai Phule, she was born in the year 1831 and she died in the year 1897. So basically, she died of bubonic plague, which was a pandemic back then. She was an Indian social reformer, educationist and poet from Maharashtra. So she belonged to Maharashtra and this thing is important. She is regarded as the first female teacher of India. Very, very important. Along with her husband, Jyoti Rao Phule, this too is important. So who was the husband of Savitri Bhai Phule? His name was Jyoti Rao Phule. They played an important role in improving women's rights in India. She is regarded as the mother of Indian feminism. Very important. So who is regarded as the mother of Indian feminism in India? She is the Savitri Bhai Phule. Also, Phule and her husband founded the first Indian girls' school in Pune at Bhirewara in 1848. So, who founded the first Indian girls' school? Basically, Savitri Bhai Phule and her husband. When in the year 1848? Where in Pune? This too is important. And here we are talking about girls' school and not the college. Further, she worked to abolish the discrimination and unfair treatment of people based on caste and gender. So she worked towards ending the caste-based discrimination as well as gender injustice, gender-based discrimination. She is regarded as an important figure of social reform movement in Maharashtra. Very, very important. A note can be asked onto the Savitri Bhai Phule as well as prelim question 2 can be asked. And moreover, Indian Express carried a detailed explained page onto this very topic. And I'll be giving the link of this thing in the description box. Kindly do go through it once. It's important. Further, these I have taken from the explained page only. The Phule started the Satya Shodhak Samaj. Satya Shodhak means society for truth seeking, through which they wanted to do lot of things. Definitely they wanted to end caste-based discrimination, gender-based discrimination, but also they initiated the practice of Satya Shodhak marriage, in which no dowry was taken. So look at the kind of advancement, the kind of broad thinking these people were having, that right at the middle of 19th century, they were talking about a marriage in which no dowry was to be taken. But even in the 21st century, we are having this very thing where dowry is an accepted norm. But yeah, anyway, so she did a lot of things. She wrote poems, Kavya Phule, Kavya Phule, Bhavan Kashi, Subodh Ratnakar and Go Get Education. The Kavya Phule was published in 1934 and Bhavan Kashi Subodh Ratnakar was published in 1982. Although she wrote in Marathi, but the underlying theme advocated values such as humanism, liberty, equality, brotherhood, nationalism and rationalism, not nationalism. We might not be having any concept of nationalism back then. It's a debatable thing, but let's just not deviate. But basically, it's rationalism here and the importance of education among others. All right. So in which language did she do her work? In Marathi. She was basically a philanthropist, that she did a lot of work for welfare of the people in general, and educationist she taught, and also a prolific Marathi writer, and she died of bubonic plague. That's it. In the 2016, a prelims question was asked, wherein we were asked to find the correct statement. Satya Shodhak Samaj organized what? Number one, a movement for upliftment of tribals in Bihar, a temple entry movement in Gujarat, an anti-caste movement in Maharashtra, a peasant movement in Punjab. So clearly, it's a very, very simple question. So as the highlighted thing is suggesting, it's an anti-caste movement in Maharashtra. So that's it. So do go through the Indian Express explained page as well, because there were certain things that I could not copy paste or have not explained them. So everything can't be explained. So long story short, do read it on your own. That's it. Further, in the same year, we were having one more prelims question about this. On which of the following can you find the Bureau of Energy Efficiency star label? Number one, ceiling fan, number 2 electric geysers, number 3 tubular fluorescent lamps. So answer here is all 3. So in all 3 we can find the BE efficiency star labeling. So if 1 star is there, it means that is not very energy efficient. If 5 stars are there, it means that electronic appliance is highly energy efficient. It is consuming very limited amount of energy. This is what basically the BE star labeling entails. So it is found in all these 3. This again is a simple question. And context is this. Basically, in this 6th January PIB, we are having this very thing that BEE notifies new energy performance standard for air conditioner. So either way, air conditioners are having this BEE star labeling and all the norms which BEE has certified, but certain changes have been brought in wherein from now onwards, that is from January 1, 2020, mandatorily the default temperature onto the ACs would be 24 degrees Celsius. That's it. Lot of information is there. Those of you who are very, very inquisitive mind can go through it on your own. I'll be providing the PDF link in the UPSC Eco channel, and the Telegram link of that channel I would be giving in the description box, so you can read it on your own. About the BEE, this too is important. Bureau of Energy Efficiency is a statutory body. So it is established as by the law of the parliament. It is under the Ministry of Power, Government of India. So it lies under Ministry of Power. It is assisted in developing policies and strategies with the primary objective of reducing the energy intensity of the Indian economy. So this is the broad objective, and under this entire thing, this broad objective, lot of things can be clubbed. So you can Google further about it and read it on your own, but either way, this is our theme. Any statement that pertains to this very thing, wherein energy intensity would be reduced and that would be saving some sort of energy, then that would be a part of BE. Nothing confusing here. That's it. Further, because the underlying idea is we cannot read everything, we have to apply our common sense. So if broad theme is this, that BEE working towards reducing the energy intensity of the Indian economy, so any statement the UPSC gonna be building, we ought to be having a fair bit of sense of understanding that could be true or not based on what we have studied from this very thing. That's it. Further, this is about the Farmer Science Congress conducted for the first time in Indian Science Congress. So Indian Science Congress, yesterday also we talked about this. Under Indian Science Congress, we're also having Women Science Congress. So maybe under 107th Indian Science Congress, it was 9th Women Science Congress also. But it was the first Farmers Science Congress. I don't know how important this is, but we have covered it either way. But this thing is important. A mention of program named ARIA. So what exactly is ARIA program? ARIA means this: attracting and retaining youth in agriculture. ARYA. Attracting and retaining youth in agriculture. That's it. It is by ICAR, that is Indian Council of Agriculture Research. So it is doing what? To improve rural bioeconomy and attract youth in agriculture, ICAR is providing training to the rural youth to be entrepreneurs and begin a startup. This is our broad objective, broad theme. Under this, if any statement is there that somehow is getting linked to this very broad theme, then that would be true. But either way, let's just read this thing on your own now. So objective of ARIA, attracting and retaining youth in agriculture, is what? So basically, ICAR is realizing the importance of youth, rural youth in agricultural development of the country, and so ICAR has initiated a program on attracting and retaining youth in agriculture. So these are its objective: to attract and empower the rural the youth in rural areas to take up various agriculture, allied and service sector enterprises for sustainable income and gainful employment in selected districts, number one. Number two is to enable the farm youth to establish network groups to take up resource and capital intensive activities like processing, value addition and marketing. So this is not just focusing on the labor intensive activities. In fact, capital intensive activities too can be undertaken. To demonstrate functional linkages with different institutions and stakeholders for convergence of opportunities available under various schemes, programs for sustainable development of youth. So if one is staying in a village, then he or she might not be having any idea what all are the institutions that are undertaking various programs in order to build onto the rural economy. So basically, ARIA would try to provide this very information to the rural youth. It would act as a functional linkage with different institutions and the youth. That's it. Further, ARIA project will be implemented in 25 states through KVKs, that is Krishi Vigyan Kendras. KVKs are Krishi Vigyan Kendras. One district from each state. So, one district would be chosen from each state. In one district, 200 to 300 rural youth will be identified for their skill development in entrepreneurial activities and establishment of related micro enterprises units. So it's a broad based objective. Anything that pertains to agriculture and its allied activities would be covered under this. KVKs will involve agriculture universities and ICR Institute as technology partners. This is either way obvious. ICR is basically undertaking a lot of research activities, is developing a lot of technology in order to upgrade, modernize agriculture. So if something is to be done for upliftment of youth that are residing in the rural area, then definitely ICR would be providing itself as a technology partner. This is either way obvious. Further, we are on to the next PIB now, and this pertains to KVIC opened first silk processing plant in Gujarat to boost production of signature Patola sari. Very, very important. It's totally factual information, nothing to be understood here. So let's go through it once. So Patola is basically what? It's a sari, but it's a signature silk of Gujarat. Patola is a double ikat. Ikat means dyeing technique, woven sari. Usually made from silk made in Patan, that is Gujarat. They are very expensive because once worn only by those belonging, because they are expensive though, so they used to be worn by people belonging to the aristocratic and royal families, because only those people were having the money to buy this. These saris are popular among those who can afford the high prices. Reason being, why exactly it is expensive? This is the reason. Raw material silk yarn is purchased from Karnataka or West Bengal, where silk processing units are situated. So raw silk is produced and then weaving is done in the Gujarat, and this is the very reason it is expensive, thus increasing the cost of fabric manifolds. Patola weaving is a closely guarded family tradition. There are three families in Patan that weave these highly priced double ikat saris. It can take 6 months to 1 year to make one sari. Due to the long process of dyeing each strand separately before weaving them together. So one strand is to be dyed and then onwards second, third, fourth, and at the end they would be weaved together to form the sari, and it takes 6 to 1 year. And either way, raw material is to be imported from the neighboring states, very far state, Karnataka and West Bengal. So this is the very reason it's very, very expensive. So that's it. Further, this is about Ujala and Street Lighting National Program. So Ujala scheme is there. Ujala stands for Unnat Jyoti by affordable LEDs for all. So LEDs otherwise are very expensive, but government is providing the subsidized LEDs to the people, not free of cost, but at the cost which is far lower than what the market price is. Alright, so Ujala and Street Lighting National Program has successfully completed 5 years. So they were launched in January 2015. So January 2020 marked completion of 5 years. Further, name is Unnat Jyoti by Affordable LEDs for All, and the second one is SLNP, that is LED Street Lighting National Program. So here in the first case, that is Unnat Jyoti by Affordable LEDs for All, the household units would be provided this very affordable LEDs, but in second case, that is SLNP, street lighting would be covered under this LED street lighting per se. That's it. Further, government of India is not providing subsidy for the execution of this very program. So it's a zero subsidy scheme. Basically, as far as I can recall, let's just read the entire thing now, then we'll review it. So here, Energy Efficiency Service Limited, which is a joint venture of PSUs under the Ministry of Power, is implementing this very scheme. Energy Efficiency Service Limited name is important. It is under PSU, but itself is a joint venture of lot of PSUs. And also, electricity distribution companies are also involved in implementation of this very scheme. Alright, further, SLNP is the world's largest street light replacement program. So it's a street light replacement program, and Ujala is the world's largest domestic lighting project. And also, India's zero subsidy Ujala scheme it is, because as far as I can recall, government is not providing subsidy. This is for sure. But how the cost would be financed now? Because if one is to replace the traditional lighting or CFL bulb with this very LED bulb, then a lot of energy would be saved. So a lot of electricity bill would be saved, and a lot of usage of electricity per se would go down, and this would be benefiting the electricity distribution companies, and the saving per se would then be given out to the this very organization, Indian Energy Efficiency Service Limited, who is implementing this very scheme. So here, government is not providing any subsidy. So there is no burden onto the exchequer, onto the government. Number one, revenue source would be the cost that consumer would be paying to this very PSU, because these LED bulbs cost somewhere around 20 to 30 rupees, and this is one source of revenue. And second one is the energy saving per se. So this would be benefiting the electricity distribution companies, and then that saving would be given out to the Energy Efficiency Service Limited. That's it. Further, same very PIB talked about Gram Swaraj Abhiyan. So this Gram Swaraj Abhiyan was launched in 2018. Here, government is doing what? Government of India initiated the Gram Swaraj Abhiyan 2018, which was aimed at promotion of social harmony by apprising rural communities of various government welfare schemes and initiatives. Gram means rural, Swaraj means self-rule, and Abhiyan means Abhiyan. So basically to promote the social harmony, and that's it. So this was just tiny information that was there in the PIB, in the same very news of Ujala. So we are done with the 3rd, 4th and 5th January PIB. Thank you so much for watching, and goodbye.